Hello, beautiful people. My name is Amanda Zitto. Today we're going to be doing a little story time about my first ever motorcycle rally, which also happened to be the first year of Dreamroll, an all-women's motorcycle rally that happens in the PNW, Pacific Northwest, for everybody who's going to ask me in the comments what PNW means. Before we get started, I need to fix something. Hold on. Okay, how does that look? Is that better? That's better. I might not be able to bring the whole motorcycle into the backyard, but I can bring the moped. It'll be our secret, you guys. And as requested, there is wine involved because some of you seem to think it's really funny when I drink, so here we are. Background information, it was 2015. I had two running motorcycles at that point. I had Lazarus and Hephaestus. Hephaestus is my 2005 Honda Shadow 750 Spirit, for those who don't know all of my bike's names yet. Especially Hephaestus, because he hasn't really been in any videos in a while. At this point, I still didn't know very many people who rode, so I went by myself. Like I said, this was like the first year of Dreamroll, so nobody knew what to expect or what it was going to be like. Some 280 women showed up to Glenwood, Washington, which is this tiny town. The town was not ready for that many women to just be there for the weekend. The poor tiny gas station in town was just like overwhelmed. All that I knew was Lana MacNaughton and her friend Becky Goebel were heading the charge. And at that point in time, I was obsessed with Lana's photography. I thought it was amazing. So I just really wanted to go and potentially meet like some of these people that I knew on social media that I thought were going to be amazing. I picked Dreamroll that year, like so many other women, because it was so much closer to me than Babes Right Out. And Babes Right Out was still in Joshua Tree at that point. It was a lot of money to get there. I didn't feel like I could do it at that point. It just seemed like too far away. And this seemed like the perfect opportunity for a first experience at a motorcycle camp out, because there was going to be so many less women than like the 600 plus that was predicted to come to Babes Right Out that year. Obviously Babes Right Out has gotten a lot bigger since then, but at that point that was the number that was expected to show up. And I was like, well, first time event, there's probably going to be way less women, right? Well, I mean, there were less women, just not the lower number that I was expecting. At this point in my evolution as a motorcycle rider, I felt very comfortable on the motorcycle, but I was still very anxious about riding around other motorcyclists. I always was worried that they were judging the way that I was doing it, or that I would find out that I was doing it wrong, and they would tell me in the harshest, meanest way possible. Totally not based on experience. I was just a big mess. So day of, even though I was so anxious the night before, I didn't sleep. I still didn't get out of the house and pack my bike and get everything ready until way late. So I didn't end up at the event until like 8 p.m. and it was twilight. But I was also watching all of these big groups of women come in after me, and nobody was solo. Everybody came in big groups. So I was just really anxious. Like, I'm not gonna be able to make friends with anybody. Everybody's gonna have their little clique. It wasn't a good feeling. So after I finished up setting up my tent, I headed towards the teepee in the Escape Collective Dome, where everybody else was kind of mingling. It was kind of the epicenter of the event, to collect my free beer. Not because I like beer, but I figured that I couldn't turn down free booze, and it might possibly help my social anxiety and kind of loosen up a little bit. I had to be able to approach people to talk to them. I got my beer. I was kind of like holding on to it for dear life, you know, that you the way that you do when you go to a social gathering and you don't know anybody there, but there's booze, so you're just kind of like cling to it like it's your lifeline. Went over to the hay bales and sat down and just like prayed that somebody else would take the initiative to talk to me. There were a couple girls that were sitting next to me on the hay bales, and one of them left. So I took that opportunity, I scooted a little bit closer to the girl that was left and kind of said, "Hi." And was extremely relieved to find out that she was just as socially awkward as I was at that point. It turned out that she was Lily Brooks Dalton, who is the author of Motorcycles I've Loved, which I talked about in my favorite motorcycle books video. If you haven't watched that yet, I'll put it above my head. It was really great to be able to identify with somebody who also didn't feel wholly comfortable in the situation. Eventually, she kind of like got up and went to bed, but it gave me the courage that I needed to talk to other people. So I timidly kind of like scooted over to somebody else and said hi. Conversation didn't come quite as naturally as it did when I was talking to Lily, but it was fine. And I kind of brought up that I needed to ask Lana about the restriction on fires and that kind of stuff because I had a camp stove that I needed to make food with because I didn't bring extra money to buy food at the event. And the gal that I was talking to like immediately just like stood up and like led me straight over to Lana, and I was very taken aback, like, oh, we're doing this now, okay. I kind of had the impression that Lana probably wasn't paying a whole lot of attention to what I was talking about, and in the middle of our conversation, her friends came over and just kind of like pulled her away, and I was like, oh, okay, I guess that's over. So the one gal and I started heading back to our tents. I kind of made excuses and went to bed. I found out the next morning that that party ended up turning into a topless dance party. Kind of felt bad about missing it the next day when I found out about it and that kind of stuff. But at the time, like, I was so tired. I don't think that I would have had the energy to hang out with that many people at that point anyway. Not that I was able to sleep until 1 a.m. until the music stopped, but I got a couple of hours of sleep, and then the pitter-patter of rain started to happen. And I, like so many other women there, hadn't even bothered to put our rain fly on because it was August and it was warm and beautiful and so dry. I don't think a whole lot of women were anticipating the rain. I got up so quickly, like I had underwear and a flannel on, and I was running trying to get my rain fly unpacked from my other bags to put onto my tent so the stuff in my tent wouldn't get wet. And I could hear everybody else like getting up and like rustling and trying to put their rain flies on in the dark. It's actually like a good thing everybody else was busy putting their rain flies on too, because nobody witnessed me literally falling back into my tent. Like, and just like icing on the cake, at about 5 a.m., the wind whipped through the airstrip and the nylon from my tent was just kind of like whipping my face and waking me up. And thankfully, like, there was enough stuff in my tent that I didn't go anywhere, that the wind didn't pick me up or anything, but it was obnoxious. And I finally gave up the fight to just sleep through it at about 8. And I got up and I headed to the main camp area to get coffee and kind of like noticed that everybody else around me was also hella haggard, either because they were one of the people who stayed up until 1 a.m. to party, or because their tent flooded. So many women's tents flooded that night. It was awful. And we all kind of huddled in one of the Escape Collective domes because it was the only area you could get out of the wind and it was kind of warm. And I was huddled in the dome with a bunch of other women when we just heard this loud snap. And one of the points where the canvas covering the dome was connected to the ground had ripped and was just like flapping in the wind. And the support staff were like immediately there, like trying to strap it back down. As he was trying to get that point down, a cascade of snaps happened and a ton of points around the canvas of the dome ripped and were just like flapping in the wind. And the women like ran out and were like trying to like hold the canvas down by sitting on it while the support staff tried to come around and reconnect the canvas to the mounting points. And that happened for a little while before they finally gave up and just like took the whole canvas down because the wind was so bad. I was kind of laughing with one of the other girls about the rain and the wind and how it really couldn't get any worse. And Lana kind of gathered everybody around and took a vote because a ton of the women had been mentioning that they just wanted to stay in camp that day, so they didn't have enough people to do two group rides, and they ended up voting to go to the waterfall, and I opted out because I didn't want to go that far. So I decided I wanted to go to the ice cave, so I went back to my tent and I layered up. I went to the main lodge to get a map, and there was a line out the door for women waiting to use the landline because there was no cell service in the airstrip where we were camping. And I saw on the floor of the main lodge, like the where you'd hang out area, there was just like a ton of air mattresses from like women's whose tent had obviously flooded during the night, and they just gave up the ghost and went into the lodge and just camped on the floor. And I went into town to get gas, and of course, like I mentioned, like Glenwood is a tiny town. Literally, it's just a gas station and like a little cafe and a general store. And they were not prepared for us being there. So there was like 6 women waiting in line for gas. And so I decided to take my chances with going to Trout Lake for gas, which turned out to be an awesome decision. I made instant friends with the little gas station attendant there in Trout Lake. He was this little old man, and I was going to kick talking to them, and found out that he was also from Montana, so we bonded over that, and he became my favorite person when he was like, oh, woman from Montana, lady who rides, can't get any better than that. So after I talked to the guy, it took me 3 tries of going back and forth and stopping and asking for directions to figure out where the ice caves were. Eventually I found them, and I pulled up and I read the little information board. It turned out it was like $5 to park there. I didn't have cash, and I watched a bunch of teenagers go into the cave, and I was like, well, I really don't want to be in a cave with a bunch of teenagers. And also I realized that the only source of light that I had was my phone. I didn't have a headlamp or anything like that. And I was like, Amanda, it's not a good idea to go into a cave with just your phone for a flashlight. And I was like, this is an excellent sign to return to my tent and take a nap. I took a nap for like 3 hours, which was so awesome. If you do ever go to a motorcycle rally, I highly encourage you to take a nap in the middle of the day. It feels amazing, especially if you were drinking the night before. So worth it. And especially because it gives you like another energy boost to be able to socialize with all those people when they come back to camp. I hid in one of the teepees with a bunch of other women when the rain came back again, and turned out to be the highlight of that whole weekend for me was sitting in that teepee, because it forced me into a group of women who didn't have any other choice but to talk to each other. And I ended up making friends with a gal from Spokane who had gone there with a group of women, but they had all ditched her that morning when it started raining and decided to go to Portland instead, and they just kind of like ducked out of the event for the rest of the weekend. Sitting in that teepee and talking to so many other women who had such an unconditional love for motorcycling was incredible. Being able to talk so openly about the struggles that I was having with learning to ride and the mechanical side of riding without worrying about people judging me was absolutely amazing, and I wouldn't trade that experience for the world. I'm not saying that you guys aren't supportive. You guys are amazing. I am thankful every day that I have this incredible community here on YouTube. But I had the misfortune of experiencing a lot of dudes who were not so supportive of women riders before I went to Dreamroll and before I found my little community of riders here in Portland. This like little experience of like getting to talk to other women riders who were having similar experiences as me was so important like to my development as a motorcyclist. Overall, I'm still really glad that I went. I'm still really glad that I went the second year. There was a lot of disillusionment that happened for sure. There were a few things about the first year of Dreamworld that wasn't awesome. The fact that so many people came in groups and only wanted to stick in their groups made it feel very cliquish. It was really hard to talk to people because they wanted to stick in their own group, and if you didn't come with them, they didn't really want to talk to you. It did kind of end up being a bit of a fashion slash photo shoot, and if you weren't a size zero and you weren't willing to wear booty shorts, you weren't in the cool group kind of thing. But getting the opportunity to talk to a bunch of other women who ride in the same place is irreplaceable. And I'm so glad that I went, and I'm glad that I went the second year, just for the experience of being surrounded by other women who ride. The difference between a good trip and a bad one is not dependent on everything going right or not. It's never always going to go right. It is dependent on our ability to wipe our faces, pick ourselves up, laugh it off, and keep going. If you made it to the end of the video, cheers to you. You are awesome. If you like this kind of content and would like to support the channel, make sure that you hit that like and subscribe button. If you want to go the extra mile and join my Magpie Parliament over on Patreon for as little as $1 a month, you can get early access to videos like these. If that's not up your alley right now, that is absolutely okay. I also have prints, stickers, t-shirts, all the good things with my motorcycle art on them, like this shirt. links down in the description to my Redbubble and my Etsy shop where you can get those. If you cannot support me monetarily right now, I absolutely understand. I appreciate you guys just for being here every week. And in the meantime, guys, I will see you later. I made tiny onigiri the other day, by the way. I figured it was pretty important for me to have something to eat while I consume all this alcohol. Question for my end screen crew. What was the first motorcycle rally that you attended? Did you go in a group? Did you go by yourself? Did it suck? Was it amazing? I want to know all the things. Let me know down in the comments. Okay, guys, I will see you later.